As Pete mentioned, I've been working in the analytics space roughly a decade, though I'm currently at Netflix. I've been at small startups, failed companies like MySpace, and even in a very, I got my start in a very traditional company in the finance sector, right? I mean, I'm talking like suits and ties and the whole shebang. So, I've been around the block a bit. Currently, I lead a data engineering and analytics group that literally supports the Netflix product. And so when I say Netflix product, I literally mean the thing you get when you hit the button and, Netflix opens up. So today, through the lens of my own career, I basically want to tell a series of stories illustrating the relationship between data engineering and data science. My goal is to sort of touch upon how an organization might think about that relationship, so current models, best practices, org structure, and how to build a team. My belief and my thesis is that a great partnership between data engineering and data science is more about creating a great culture by hiring the right people than anything else. So now I think for many of us, data engineering and data science are sort of like a couple in a highly dysfunctional relationship. When I was thinking about this talk, as strange as this sounds, I thought the rapper Eminem captured the dynamic best when he says, and I'm not going to rap it because this is being recorded and whatever's recorded is going to live on the internet forever. But Eminem says, "Where are you going? I'm leaving you. No, you ain't. Come back. We're running right back. Here we go. Go again. It's so insane because when it's going good, it's going great. I'm Superman with the wind at his back. She's Lois Lane. But when it's bad, it's awful." So those words, when it's going good, it's going great. But when it's bad, it's awful, I think can describe the relationship between the two disciplines. So today I'm going to talk about some Superman moments, and then I'm going to talk about some moments from my own career when it's basically just been absolutely awful. And I think if nothing else, hopefully you'll be entertained. But I suspect, right, like if we think about the stories, there's a few lessons to be learned if we reflect on them. So the first story that I wanted to share with you all, frankly, may be one of the most awkward moments I've ever experienced professionally. It happened at a company previous to Netflix. One day, a bunch of us were basically sitting at our desks, minding our own business, busily coding away, when a senior leader in the analytics org walks up to a senior leader in the data engineering org and starts to share like a rather strongly held opinion about how the data engineers ought to be doing their job. Now, how many people in the room here today just love it when someone comes up to you and tells you how you ought to be doing your job, right? We got one. Especially when they're highly opinionated but not very knowledgeable. So, as you could expect, the data engineering leader just loved it. You know, that being said, I can also kind of understand where the analytics leader was coming from, right? Because without data, a data scientist is sort of like dead in the water, right? He or she literally can't deliver, which would understandably be pretty frustrating. So it seems like they ought to have some input, right? So it was right about now that a few of us close by started noticing the conversation. Voices starting to rise, hands kind of getting waving around, animating a little bit. That subtle shift in tone from polite to irritated. Now, for whatever reason that day, these two leaders, they lost it. And the next thing we know, they're both, and this is like in a professional setting, like in an office, cubes, people all over the place. They're both yelling at each other, screaming at each other, going back and forth multiple times, dropping the F-bomb. Literally everyone within 100 yards stops what they're doing and is watching by now. The heads start like popping up and they start turning and people are trying to figure out what's going on. After one final like epic verbal volley, the two stomp off to the CTO's office so that he can referee. At which point, everyone that had been like watching sort of is like, phew, instantly sort of starts staring back down at their desk because no one wants to make eye contact because this is huge, awkward moment. Now, there was probably a lot going on between those two, but one thing that I think that was definitely happening was a battle for control, right? The analytics guy knew exactly what he wanted and the engineer didn't like being controlled. In hindsight, I think perhaps a better approach may have been for that analytics leader to start first by offering context about his goals rather than attempting to control implementation. Telling the engineer why something was valuable, not dictating how things needed to occur. And then trusting his coworker to make a great choice in his own area of expertise. I think great partnerships between data engineering and data science require a relationship that's built more on shared context and sharing context versus battles for control. So I want to unpack that a little bit today. So a few thoughts. Context, not control, I think first requires employees who put the company first. If you're trusting people to make their own great choices, you want somebody who's selfless. You want somebody who has integrity to prioritize the company's interests. You also want people who have great judgment and who are mature. So at home, I have two toddlers, twin boys, and a four-year-old. For those of you who are parents in the room, you know that you just can't give your little kid like context on why they should look before crossing the street, or why it's a bad idea to touch a hot stove, or why they can't have chocolate for dinner, or why it's not good to play in the toilet bowl, and on and on and on it goes. Sometimes you literally just, and the parents are chuckling because they've been there. Sometimes you literally have to step in and sort of control, right, before someone dies. They're too little and young to be given total freedom. So context, not control, works best with maturity, right? But it can be dangerous in the wrong situation. So for an example, we recently at Netflix enabled sign up an app on iOS devices. So as you can imagine, we use quite a bit of data to make that decision. So what did context, not control, what did that sort of working relationship between data engineers, data scientists, and product managers look like for that decision? So basically, pretty simple. A few data engineers and data scientists got together with a product manager and began talking about various approaches to figuring out what kind of data we might use to make the decision. Ultimately, after much research, vigorous debate, we made a decision to go forward with iOS and app signup. That was last fall. So okay, so now the analysis is done, the decision's been made, now it's time to go out and to do it, right, to build it. From the data side, we began executing on building the necessary tracking and metrics to measure whether or not, you know, this was a success post-launch. Now, I was leading the team, but I wasn't in any of those meetings. Well, I think I was actually in one. But as a leader, I basically looped my people in on the project. I gave them context on the overall strategic importance of the company, and then trusted them to partner together with a business to basically get it done. I mean, you can sort of imagine how horribly wrong this could go with the wrong team. The leader would need to be much more hands-on leading the project. So I think having great people is essential. So second idea, I think context, not control, also works best with transparency across the board, right? The business needs to be open with their goals, their strategy, open with data, with their product plans, with access to leaders. Data engineers and scientists also, frankly, they need to be open with each other, not just on what they want from with each other, but like why they want it. A secretive culture means that employees, they lack the knowledge they need to make great decisions. At times, you know, over the years, I've seen a tendency for data engineers or data scientists to sort of guard the details of why we're doing something. I guess I shouldn't have chosen a black background here. They want to guard the details of why they're doing something or why they want something. So, you know, obviously, look, there's an appropriate and relevant level of information to be shared, but I'm of the opinion that the data scientists, frankly, they get better data pipelines when they transparently give engineers context on their analytical interests, and vice versa. Data engineers might find much more flexible and understanding partners if they help the data scientists understand the implications and or the trade-offs and the costs that's involved in their request. For the leaders here in the room, for those of us that are leaders, and this can frankly be a hard one, it means we really need to risk trusting our people. Personally, as a leader, I found that when I have great people on my team, people who are frankly now often more technical than I am, people who are closer to the data, who are working directly with stakeholders and peers, frankly, they're likely in a better, more informed place than I am to make the call. So why should I micromanage them, right? Frankly, it doesn't scale. I've seen it result in worse decisions. I think all of us probably have seen that. And I've also seen it drive really talented people absolutely nuts, and it makes them want to leave. At least that's what micromanagement does for me. I think especially in the data world, context not control also frankly plays out in terms of how we structure our organization, how we organize ourselves. I think at many times it's common to have data engineering and reporting and analytical people all on sort of separate teams, right? In other words, companies, they cluster people together based on similar skills. Now, there's certainly advantages to that model, but one big disadvantage is that when the business is trying to get a project done fast, relevant teams begin to lose, context, frankly, begins to be lost as more and more teams are drawn in. And this is especially true in the world, I think, of the abstract world of ideas and of data. Plus, practically speaking, prioritization just gets complicated, right, with multiple teams in the mix. So I found, you know, at Netflix that it can be helpful to organize our organization in a way that maximizes context and shared collaboration. So what that means for us is to put the data engineers and data scientists on the same team. As many of you know, doing good data science means you actually sort of need to understand the data that you're working with. And frankly, what better way to understand your data than by literally sitting next to the data engineer that's producing it? Or vice versa. You get the best data pipelines with the least amount of rework when your data engineers understand the questions, right, that the business is trying to answer, the model that the data scientists are trying to build. So rather than building separate data engineering and data science orgs, I've seen a lot of success building a product data org, right, composed of people with diverse skill sets and a lot of shared context. So at my current employer, right, so we've organized ourselves into teams that are sort of vertical, there's a team supporting product, a team supporting marketing, a team supporting content, a team supporting streaming and finance and customer service, with each of these teams having a diverse set of data engineering, analysis, and visualization skills. We frankly believe that this helps us optimize our organizational structure for maximum shared business context. All right, so another story. So I was working as a data engineer a few years ago, and I had a data science colleague who I found particularly difficult to work with. Not sure if any of you guys out there can identify with this, but there was one meeting in particular where it became really apparent that she and I were at odds, and we had some really strongly held different opinions about the direction that we ought to go. She really wanted my team to focus on a particular project supporting her group, and I wanted my team to focus on a different project. In fact, we were in a meeting to discuss the project that I wanted to work on, and she kept trying to like steer the conversation towards the project she wanted us to work on, and of which, of course, I resisted, right? I think this is a fairly familiar pattern in our space, particularly given the fact that data engineers are often building the foundation for much of the work that is done by data scientists. So she and I were civil, no F-bombs, no temper tantrums, no running off to our CEO to sort of mediate. But what we did do was that instead of talking with each other about what had happened, we both went to our own sort of separate managers. Instead of being direct, we were indirect. Instead of focusing on the issue, we began to suspect the sort of intentions and the motivations of the other person. In short, I think she and I were both lacking a little honesty and, frankly, courage. One lesson that I personally learned from that experience is that I think great partnerships between data engineers and data scientists, they're built on honesty and courage. So I want to talk a little bit more about that. So I need to acknowledge, frankly, to you guys that practicing honesty and courage can sometimes be intimidating or risky given your situation. But I've personally found that there's pretty much always two options, which is basically you pay now or you pay later, right? Either be honest with your perspective or, frankly, ignore what's going on, perhaps sort of like stuff it down until at some point someone explodes in anger. So we can sort of face the problem or we can let it fester. Honesty and courage is also about being direct versus working through proxies. And frankly, when you've made a mistake, right, because we all screw up, whether personal or technical, it's about quickly sort of admitting the mistake and moving to fix it. I think the two words, I'm sorry, might be the two most difficult words to say in the English language. Sunshining mistakes is the first step, in my opinion, to fixing the relationship, to regaining the technical trust of the people that you've been collaborating with. And especially, right, like in our world of data and data quality problems and bugs, you've got to fess up quickly and own it. You not only risk damaging your and your team's reputation, but there's real danger to the business that's using the data that you're producing. So, you know, what's the phrase? It's not the crime, but it's the cover-up that gets you. So honesty and courage. Now, to be clear, honesty and courage isn't just about resolving personal problems, right? I think it also means cultivating a culture of vigorous Socratic debate about the issues. Whether building data pipelines or analyzing data or applying data to crucial product decisions, I found that multiple minds and perspectives nearly always results in a better solution or a better decision. All too often, I think data scientists and engineers can sort of slip right into order-taking mode, either with each other or with stakeholders, with the business. A culture of honesty and courage means that engineers ask scientists why they need something. The scientist challenges the engineer if they're really making the appropriate level of investment. Or both engineers and scientists openly discuss with the business whether something is a good idea, or whether a given project really has the business impact to deserve that level of prioritization. Rather than the business saying, here's the analysis or the data that I want, it's the data engineers and scientists saying, hey, that's a great question, and you know, we could do that for you. But did you know, based on the context that you've given us and the data that I've seen, that what you really might want to look at is, you know, sort of fill in the blank? So my team currently supports product managers, and I'm constantly encouraging the product managers to provide business context to the team. And then I'm encouraging my analysts and scientists to sort of respectfully push back on the business if and when that makes sense. Or better yet, frankly, to continually pitch new ideas to the business based on the context that they have and the data that they're seeing. Or best, to literally have a seat at the table where the product decisions are being made and using the data and analysis that they've provided. That's using the data analysis that they provided. Because ultimately, right, like, isn't that sort of what it's all about? Using data to make the business better? And sometimes, you know, in my experience, that means having really hard conversations where you say, that's a really, like, fun product idea, seems to make a lot of sense, but, you know, I'm sorry, like, the data just doesn't back it up. Having those kind of conversations requires a willingness to be honest. And depending on your context, frankly, it can require a lot of courage. So a few caveats. Honesty and courage, though, shouldn't be mistaken for a lack of humility. It shouldn't be mistaken for a lack of compassion or a lack of tact. It also shouldn't be mistaken as an opportunity to micromanage your fellow teams. I think if done well, it's a very open, direct, and at times creative conversation between experts in a given area. All right, so another story. In recent years, I think one of the big successes we've had at Netflix has been the work that we've been doing with anomaly detection, right? So in the world of big data, it would take armies of analysts to find all of the relevant and unusual patterns or anomalies, given all of the metrics and all the possible permutations of filters. So our thought is, why not let machines do what machines are really good at, which is crunching through vast quantities of data, discovering those interesting anomalies for us. So a couple of applications. One particularly problematic area for us is in the payment space, right? With all the various forms of payments across the world, all the various banks, payment processors, plus with all of the fraud out there, and the fraudsters are relentless, they just keep coming. This was an area where Netflix was losing real money due to our inability to detect and to react to the countless little issues that can pop up in such a vast network. We were too reactive, living in a state sort of constant vigilance. Or another use case, in the world of data engineering, right? Given the enormous volumes of data, all the different types of events, all the groups that are sending events, it's really easy, frankly, for something to go wrong. Some particular element on some event might get messed up, and no one's gonna notice for a while. And of course, frankly, there's nothing that your business or your analytics partners love more than finding out that the data that they were counting on is wrong. So we're solving this problem today by creating some really cool math and then building on a framework that data teams across a company can use to audit their data, to look for anomalies, and to raise an alarm, all the while minimizing false positives. So how did this happen? So this system was built by collaboration between data engineers from multiple teams and data scientists coming together. The idea and the initiative came from individual contributors, not managers. There was never, you know, my team was involved in helping to make this happen with other teams. There was never formal manager approval. No one ever asked me, hey, can we do this? Right? There was no official project plans, no project managers, no cross-departmental buy-in conversations, right? The work just happened naturally and organically. There were conversations, of course, right? There was coordination and there was organization among people executing on the projects, right? Like, there was meetings. But I would sort of characterize the whole endeavor as an example of teams being highly aligned but loosely coupled. The basic idea of highly aligned, loosely coupled is to get a bunch of high-performing people together, to give them the appropriate context on strategy and goals, and then to release them to basically go do something awesome. So as we think about today about how data engineers and scientists interrelate within a company, I think the whole model of highly aligned, loosely coupled is an important strategic choice and one that I want to talk about a bit more. So I've worked at companies before that are highly aligned, highly coupled, right? as an example of highly aligned, highly coupled, think more about maybe a traditional data environment, right? With like central architects, complex approval and change management processes. You need official sign-off from all teams before embarking upon a project. If a data scientist needs new data, there's about 15 tickets needing approval and a 1-year lead time before access is granted, right? I don't know about you all, but I find that kind of soul-crushing bureaucracy to be absolutely stifling, exhausting, and frankly destructive to innovation. So that's highly aligned, highly coupled, right? And I trust that we've all seen that at various places. In the data world, by the way, we particularly, I think, we like this approach because it tends to minimize mistakes and problems, right? But it trades off speed in exchange for perfection. Or then there's the other extreme, right? Loosely aligned, loosely coupled. And you know, before I talk about loosely aligned and loosely coupled, I just want to make one quick comment. There are perhaps some situations where highly aligned and highly coupled does make sense. So there are situations, there's companies where perfection's necessary. There's absolutely no room for mistake. There's no room for mistake. So just that little caveat out there that you know some of this depends on the context of your individual company. Okay, so the other extreme, loosely aligned, loosely coupled. Now look, I think we all would agree that some coordination in organization, right, is not necessarily a bad thing. The anomaly detection example I gave earlier only happened because data scientists and engineers were aligned on strategic goals, and they were bringing their best ideas to the table to work together, right? So there's real power in getting different teams in an organization working towards a common focused objective with a shared strategy. So I'll never forget, I was interviewing at a company here in the Valley, which I'll leave nameless. And it was my sense that this particular organization was a little loosely aligned and loosely coupled, and it was driving the stakeholders nuts. And there was, two things that sort of tipped me off. The first was that a leader in the org told me that they needed me to join up because I was a bit more senior, and they needed senior people because things at this particular company were a little bit like Lord of the Flies, which, I'm not sure how many of you have read the book, but the basic gist is that a bunch of young kids are left to govern themselves on a deserted island and disaster and craziness ensues. So not exactly like a flattering analogy, which a quick pro tip, by the way, for those of you out there recruiting, comparing your environment to Lord of the Flies when trying to close a candidate. I mean, in the book, someone literally gets hunted down and killed, right? So just, I don't know, I digress. But the other thing that sort of tipped me off that things weren't going that well there was that, during one of my interviews, I literally spent the entire 45 minutes listening and empathizing with this team's customer rant about the constant chaos. She literally didn't ask me a single question. She spent the entire time just ranting about the chaos of the environment. So that's loosely aligned, loosely coupled. Lots of speed, but lots of chaos. Okay, so in the data world, is there really sort of this continuum, right? With speed and chaos on one side versus perfection and bureaucracy on the other. Is that a trade-off that we're sort of forced to make? Sort of like pick your poison, right? So I do, I think there's an alternative, right? I think highly aligned, loosely coupled is a solution, and I want to sort of sketch it out. But before I do that, I want to lay out some of the constraints of this problem. So one of the mandates for the data teams at Netflix is that there's order, right? That they present to the business a coherent single version of truth. For example, now that, making sure that when different teams say somebody watched a show or that someone is a current member, that we're all operating with the same definition and the same version of the truth, right? Because obviously there can be some sort of nuance to those definitions. And it would be difficult, frankly, to use data to run your company if there was no consistency. But there's also this mandate to move quickly, to be flexible. So how do we get speed with order and consistency? So here's a bit how we approach it. First, we agree on strategy and principles. For example, there are certain patterns people tend to follow when modeling or laying out data, or we have certain data lifecycle management standards, or there are highly supported best practices when creating data sets and jobs. There are highly supported tools and approaches to solving common shared problems, which as an aside, one thing that we've learned for those of you out there in the tool world, is that when you don't have to make something mandatory if you make it easy, especially if it makes the life of the developer or the data scientist easier. You get amazing adoption. Second, for us, highly aligned, loosely coupled, looks like hiring mature and seasoned individuals. frankly, there's better ways of doing things. And more seasoned data engineers and scientists, frankly, they've screwed up, they've suffered, they've learned from the pain, and now they do things a better way. All that to say, if you bring in people who have learned from failures because they've been taking risks, and therefore they sort of have a great breadth and depth of experience, being loosely coupled just works out better. Third, being highly aligned and loosely coupled means proactively sending out and seeking out information. You want proactive people. If I think someone could be impacted by my change, or if I don't fully understand some data set, we try to use our feet, right? Get up, go talk to someone. Which, by the way, one easy way to sort of gently aid and improve alignment is to literally physically situate similar teams together. I'm convinced that there's some sort of inverse mathematical relationship between the number of stairs between me and another team and the likelihood that I'm actually going to get up out of my seat and go talk to someone. So, you know, co-locating data engineers and scientists with each other and the relevant business partners is ideal when possible. And then here's what we don't do in terms of remaining highly aligned but loosely coupled. There's no limiting of access to data, right? No approval process to push code or make changes, and no enforcement of rules. We basically let what happens happen in a loosely coupled way. And for the most part, it just works out. Yes, you know, there can occasionally be duplicated effort, frankly, but I think moving fast is worth it. In the Valley and in the tech space, things change so rapidly that it's, I think, increasingly more valuable to err on the side of speed. As a manager within this paradigm, one of my key jobs then is to sort of focus on ensuring strategic alignment and providing context. And I often, frankly, do this in an informal fashion through one-on-ones with key leaders and partners. A lot of what I do is to sort of intuitively connect the dots between different teams and different themes. There's a lot of, hey, you should talk with this team, or the problem or solution that you're talking about sounds an awful lot like something this other team over here is doing. All this to say, today I can't give you a formula for what it means for your data engineers and scientists to be highly aligned and loosely coupled in your context. I think as organizations, as they grow and as they scale over time, I think preserving strong alignment with loose coupling requires constant innovation. There was a day at Netflix where the data team could all sit together basically like in a big bullpen. And alignment was literally just a matter of, you know, turning around in your chair and shouting out a question or idea, sort of like, hey everyone, I'm gonna drop a table, right? Now, alignment means we build tools, for example, to help us find dependencies, to find who or what is consuming our data. Now, alignment means creating maybe a cross-functional working group where the data engineers or data scientists get together and we align on goals and strategies and best practices or techniques in a particular domain. Now, alignment means even investing maybe in a data ops person or a data ops team to help multiple data teams sort of cooperatively inhabit this shared space and ecosystem while retaining, obviously, their freedom and their independence. So the detailed implementation techniques of achieving highly aligned and loosely coupled, are they're ever changing as a company scales. But I think some of the strategies, right, of hiring great people, agreeing on principles, leveraging leaders to ensure alignment and to provide context, and building out tools, I think those strategies are timeless. One other final thing that I want to emphasize, for this I think to really work, you need people with the right motivations. You want to hire people who desire impact over owning territory, people who look for impact more than title. I think you want to look for people who want to build cool stuff versus building personal empires. Motivations matter. And judgment matters, right? Like, you want someone who doesn't need a highly coupled environment, who knows when to talk to other teams, and who is a collaborative team player doing what's best for the business. Someone who is flexible and willing to evolve as the business scales. Having strong alignment but loose coupling among your data engineers and data scientists, I think means you can be big, fast, and flexible. You can accomplish amazing goals without the headache of chaos or the bureaucracy and the overhead of the bureaucracy. Okay, so one final story. But before I share, you know, some of you may have realized by now that a lot of these ideas that I'm talking about today around culture, frankly, they're not original with me. And to give fair credit where it's due, many of these ideas are found in my company's culture deck. And when I was asked by Pete to speak about the relationship between data engineering and data scientists, or data science at Netflix, I realized that I really couldn't talk about that relationship without looking at the company culture that I think makes that relationship work so well. So that was really, you know, why I ended up sort of structuring this talk the way I did. Now, that being said, though, you know, like a lot of companies, we've certainly had our fair share of bumps along the way. One topic of debate, and frankly, even occasional ongoing tension at Netflix as recently as like a month ago, I was involved in conversations around this, has been the question of where does data engineering and data science belong within the company, right? Should there be just one or two teams that are the official sort of blessed practitioners? Pragmatically speaking, I think there's certainly an argument to be made that there's value, right, in centralizing according to technical expertise. Today at Netflix, the reality is that there's several teams where the lion's share of data engineering and data science occurs. But that being said, no one team owns techniques or tools. And so I would sort of sum this mentality up with a label, freedom and responsibility. You know, can or should a data scientist write a data pipeline? Can or should a data engineer build a predictive model? Frankly, I think those are the wrong questions to be asking. Rather than debating who can write a data pipeline or build a predictive model, I think the primary focus really needs to be on making a great impact and doing what's best for the company, right? Sometimes the answer to those questions of building who builds a model or who builds a pipeline, sometimes the answer is yes. Sometimes the answer will be no. I think the bottom line is that there's a ton of work to do and not a lot of value investing emotional energy in these sort of existentially and personally threatening debates over where to permanently draw a line. Anyone can do anything, but frankly, you better be competent or you're going to be called out, right? And for the most part, if you have the right people, they tend to know what they're good at, and stuff just sort of works out, right? They know when to chip in and do something outside of their area of expertise because it's all hands on deck at the moment, versus when to bow out and let the experts take over, right? They realize that data scientists doing data engineering or data engineers doing data science is not always the best thing. They know that, frankly, increased specialization almost always comes, right, with increased scale. What I'm suggesting then is that there's no easy one-size-fits-all answer to the question of where do these disciplines belong or who can practice them. I think the answer is often, well, it depends. The answer, I think, more generally, is to hire responsible people and give them, frankly, the freedom to work out what makes sense in a given situation. So today, I hope I've given you guys a lot to think about today. You know, in my opinion, I think having a great relationship between data engineers and data scientists means practicing honesty, not control, context, not control, honesty and courage, aiming to be highly aligned but loosely coupled, and allowing freedom but frankly requiring responsibility. I think it starts with creating a great culture with the right people rather than identifying a perfect org structure, or hiring tremendous technical talent, or buying or building the world's best data platform. And to create that culture means that you need to hire the right team. But once you've gotten there, I think you can finally, you know, hopefully drop the Eminem lyrics and maybe start singing or listening to some James Brown singing "I Feel Good." So, thanks for your time today. Any questions? Yeah, I can't see a thing out there.
Questions?
So you had talked about the idea of putting data scientists and data engineers together, which I think is great.
Yep.
I think the one problem with that is that you tend to start to align on like the biggest initiatives. You know, like let's say there's three top initiatives in the company to work on, and then there may be three teams to formulate for that. But then there's all this kind of like loose ends and maybe leveraged work that needs to happen that may not fall into those buckets. So how do you think about that, or how does that get managed?
So if I'm understanding your question right, you know, I think it's, first off, I think it's good that people are aligning around like the biggest initiatives of the company, right? Because we want to put our resources where we're going to get our biggest bang for the buck. But if I'm understanding your question right, like these loose ends, like maybe what you mean by that is like technical debt or like, you know, cleaning up bad code, right? Honestly, I think that is a problem. I think the way you get around that is you hire people who have really great judgment, people who can say to the business, yeah, I'm all in, I'm doing this project, or hey, you know what, I just delivered a whole bunch of stuff to you. I need to take a week, I need to take a break, I need to pause, I need to go back and clean some stuff up. I need to optimize my code. We moved really fast. We got it out the door. Now we need to pause and go back, sort of, you know, and clean it up. And this comes, you know, like if you've got a culture where you've hired great people, like if the business really trusts you, if the business thinks you're awesome and you think the business is awesome and you've got that trusting relationship, then my experience with the business is saying is, yeah, you're awesome. Take the time. I trust you. You're right, right? So it's that mindset where we're not slaves to the business, we're not servants to the business, we're peers, and we're equals, and they trust us to make the call and have the judgment. So did I kind of get to your question?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so in practice, you were talking a lot about, you know, putting data scientists and data engineers together. A question I have is, so how do you deal with the project management and task management in theory, or even in practice of, you know, are you putting people on the same team and assigning tasks? Like, how do you think about ownership and scheduling and things like that?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I've been asked that before. This might surprise some of you. I think in the entire company, there's something like 2,500 people. I think there's one project manager in the entire company that works in one particular team. So we have no project managers. I'll tell you a little bit about how it works in my world in terms of how I partner with product managers. So every quarter and every year, I sit down with the product managers and we try and figure out like, okay, what are your biggest goals, right? And the product manager, let's say the product manager in the area of trying to get more people to sign up, might say, well, I really want to improve how former members sign up. And another big goal I have is to, you know, we've gone global now, and so we need to sort of, you know, have more languages on the non-member homepage, right? So they're going to have some major strategic goals. Okay, so we sit with them and we map out those strategic goals, and we figure out what we need to do to make that happen. At the same time, like, you're in the product world. I mean, questions come up all the time. Hey, we had an idea. There's these little one-offs, right? And so I sort of have this paradigm. You might think of like a jar, right? And you can fill the jar with sand, or you can fill the jar with big rocks, right? So to me, like, the big rocks are the big strategic initiatives. What I want to do is I want to put the big rocks in the jar first, and then I want to kind of pour the sand, i.e. all the little one-offs, all the little ad hoc requests around it. And so what we do is we sit down with the product managers at the beginning of the quarter, we identify what those big rocks are, and then I meet with them about once a month and I try and say, hey, this is what we've been doing the past month. We've been making progress on your big rocks, or we haven't been because we've been handling all of these little one-offs, all these little ad hoc questions. And that tends to work really well for us because it allows us on the one hand to sort of clear the space that we need to focus on the strategic projects, but it also gives us the flexibility that everybody wants to go off and chase these one-offs as they kind of come up. So it's sort of informal, right? All the analysts and people on my team, they meet directly with the product managers on a weekly basis, often multiple times a week. Frankly, the requests from the product managers, they fly back and forth all the time. I don't even probably see half to three quarters of the requests that go on. And so a lot of, then what I do when I meet with the people on my team is I ask them, hey, how's it going? What have you been working on? And I constantly encourage them and coach them to push back with the product managers, right? So it's about, you know, helping the people on your team, like hiring people who have really good, a good sense of the business, who have good judgment, and who themselves can say, okay, this project is more valuable than this project. And then who have the courage to say to the project manager, I disagree with you. And then it's about a conversation. It's about having that trusting relationship. So it's a sort of a decentralized approach. It's very decentralized in terms of how we approach project management and prioritization and things like that. So does that kind of answer your question? Cool.
So I know you had advocated to hire more seasoned people with experience. What do you do with the more junior data scientists and engineers? Do you do anything differently?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, to be really candid with you, we don't necessarily hire a ton, but we do hire some. Because I think, you know, so as a leader, when I think about the team, I don't want to necessarily have a team. If I have a team of 10 people, I don't probably want to have a team of 10 super junior people, right? Just because that was going to, it kind of like doesn't necessarily work that well with the culture and the approach that we've set out, right? Like, so what I think about, the way I think about it is like if I have 3 or 4 or 5 really seasoned people, then I can afford, if you will, to hire somebody who's more junior to bring them in and to pair them up. So, you know, when I hire, I think I really look for attitude and aptitude, like, and then technical skills and experience, that's like third on my list of priorities in terms of what I want, right? Like, I want a certain basic minimum level, But what I really want is I want the culture fit. I want somebody who has tremendous aptitude, somebody who's smart, right? Like, you can't just teach smart, right? It's hard to teach courage. It's hard to teach honesty. It's hard to teach these things. Like, those are things that you tend to either have or you don't have, whether you're junior or whether you're senior. But there is something to having some experience, right? And so you can bring somebody in with less experience, but I think you do so when your team has more experienced leaders around that person that you can sort of pair up, right? And you also have to think about, like, do I have the relevant work on my team that I could keep a junior person really busy with, right? Do I have the work that somebody who's more junior could learn and then become more seasoned? Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Someone else.
I guess I'm kind of getting stuck on project management because it sounds so different than what we do.
Yeah.
I'm picturing, how does an engineer deal with having three or four different stakeholders and managing priorities from all of them?
Yeah, that's a great question, and that happens all the time. I mean, it's a couple of things. Like, the engineer thinks about across all of the projects what's the most valuable and then works there and then communicates on a regular basis to all those stakeholders, this is where my time and where my resources are going. So, I mean, part of the strategy is you try to structure your organization where you don't necessarily have a lot of that. So I kind of alluded to it earlier that, you know, broadly speaking, there's a group that supports product, in a group that supports streaming, in a group that supports finance. So it's not like one team supports the entire stinking company. And then even within my organization, I've actually got three different teams. Those three different teams are aligned with three different product management organizations, three different PMO groups, right? So I've got one team that supports personalization algorithms at Netflix, right? And there's three or four PMs in that team, right? And that PM team has a leader. So, you know, part of what you can do is, like, three or four different PMs could all ask that team for multiple competing requests. And part of what you can do is go back to that team and say, okay, team of requesters, you've asked for three or four things. Here's my opinion on what matters the most. You guys also, like, and it's just a conversation. So, it requires a conversation. It requires great judgment. It requires great people, selfless people, people who are willing to put the company first versus putting their own pet project first. Right? Because, I mean, I'm just being honest. Like, how many of us, like, we get attached to a project and I want resources to get my project done? And that's understandable. Like, that's kind of human nature, I think. But, I mean, hopefully you're looking for somebody who can say, you know, that project I had, good project, but wow, this other thing that you all are working on is even probably more valuable. Okay, so do the other thing first. Yes, you need a high degree of maturity across the entire company for this to work. If you don't have that, like, if you have a bunch of junior product managers who are petty and arguing and political, not going to work. Totally not going to work. Yeah, that's a challenge.
Ladies first.
Do you have any suggestions to shake up the dynamic where product and data science are always reaching for the gas pedal and engineering is slamming on the brakes? Because I don't like being the asshole who always has to say no.
Yeah.
I don't like being the person being like, you can't overload this schema, because if you do, our data quality will be bad, and then our reports will break, and, like, that'll suck, and you can't do this. I'm always the person saying no, and it makes me feel bad. I want to be the person sometimes being like, I want to try this crazy thing, but if everybody does that, everything just spirals out of control. So, like, how do you... I don't want to be an asshole, but I, at the same time, don't want things to explode. So what do I do?
Yeah, that's a hard question.
Be the asshole.
Maybe be the asshole? I don't know.
Always the asshole.
You know?
I
guess, a few thoughts, right? Like, there may be times when you need to be the asshole, but I guess you could kind of ask yourself, do I always need to be the asshole? Like, maybe there is a project where you can kind of go crazy. Like, does it really matter? It's kind of what I'm getting at, right? Like, and I'm sure you think about that, but there may be situations and scenarios where you can, like, do that. I also think, I think some of that, too, is like, you feel like you're being a jerk, but I think, like, you could kind of reframe that in your own mind, and you could reframe that with your stakeholders, that, like, actually, I know I'm saying no to you, but I'm saying no to you because it's really good for you, and it's really good for the company, right? It's like you're kind of being their mom. It's like me saying to my kids, right? Like, no, you can't eat chocolate for dinner. Trust me, it's good for you. Like, my kids never want to take a nap. They never want to go to bed at night. They would stay up all night. But, like, they don't know that, like, hey, no, it's, you kind of need to sleep. So, I don't know. You're in a tough position. I feel for you. I'm sorry. But you got to do it. And I think you having the courage and honesty to do it is awesome. Yeah, somebody's got to do it.
Hey. So you've mentioned about empowering your team members and trusting them to drive the tasks that they're responsible for.
Yes.
And I've seen that working in many different environments. But every now and then, even in great cultures, you've seen people abusing that trust.
Yeah.
Have you ever identified that and what your approach is?
No, I mean, I think that absolutely happens. There's a really public example that was in the news media. Where a Netflix executive, you could Google it, and this is very public information, was actually signing contracts and then getting kickbacks. He left the company, we figured it out afterwards, and I think we're like suing him right now in court. Just to like, you know, so yeah, it happens, to be really candid. You know, if it happens, you obviously deal with it, depending on the situation. I mean, if it's a really egregious thing like that, you probably fire somebody, and there's, I don't know, criminal stuff and legal stuff. If it's maybe a more subtle situation, I think you kind of fall back on the honesty and courage piece, and you have a really candid conversation with somebody like, hey, I think you're abusing the trust here. You need to stop it. So there's a risk to this freedom culture, but I mean, to be really blunt with you, I think we would rather, you know, all said and done, when we think about the calculus and we think about the equation, there's more benefit in giving the freedom and getting the risk than cutting off freedom, right? So I'll give you another example, right? Everybody on my team can buy whatever they want. They get reimbursed. And then at the end of the month, I get an email saying how much people on my team spent after they've already been reimbursed by the company. So it's that's freedom, right? But there's some responsibility. Like I can see names, I can see numbers for the most part. I don't ever like follow up with any of my team members, you know. But if I see like, you know, Chris spent $30,000 on something, I might swing by Chris's cube and say, hey, notice you spent 30 grand this month on something. What was that about? You know? So it's, yeah, anyway, I digress. I'm yeah.